Wait. You have a TV?
No. I just like to read the TV guide. Read the TV guide. You don't need a TV.
Hello, everybody. Ken Reed here. Welcome to TV Guidance Counselor. As always, I am here to discuss classic television with a guest of interest to me and probably to you, a comedian, a musician, a friend, a writer, someone interesting, which is kind of everybody. Everyone has an interesting story about the television we all watched growing up, sort of pre-millennium, using back issues of TV Guide magazine as our doorways into the collective past. And today my guest is comedian Sean Patton. Sean is very, very funny. I met him, years ago when he was doing some shows up here in Boston. Always enjoy his work. He was on Best Buyers in America with a friend of the show, former guest of the show, Jay Larson. Very funny comedian. Was here recently doing some shows at Laugh Boston. So we grabbed some time and talked TV circa 1978. So this was a fun chat. If you would like to email me, I sometimes say this at the end of the show, but I'm going to say it at the beginning of the show this week. If you'd like to email me at tvguidancecounselor@gmail.com or ken@icanread.com, you can do so. And if you want to request guests, you want to ask questions, anything like that, I welcome those sorts of inquiries. And a lot of people recently have been writing me about where to find shows we talk about. And weirdly, I've noticed, and I don't know if this is just an oversight by the copyright gods, but a lot of this stuff's getting posted on YouTube recently and hasn't been pulled down quickly. So if there's something you're looking for, search there first. You might actually, I know that sounds dumb. That's like when someone goes to a record store and they're like, do you have the Ramones? And you're like, did you look in R? Maybe that's just me. Remember record stores? Anyway, but take a look there. And, if you don't find it, I'm happy to see what I can dig up for you. Anyway, speaking of digging, this has nothing to do with that. Neither of us dig anything in this episode. We're interrupted a little bit in the end there, and we move to a different location. We're at the West End Hotel at Fort Point Channel, where Laugh Boston is. But anyway, this is a fun chat, so please sit back, relax, and enjoy my conversation on TV Guidance Counselor with the one and only Sean Patton.
TV is my friend, and it has been always there for me.
Patton, how are you?
Hello, Ken. How are you? Thank you for taking the time to take the time with me.
You're quite welcome.
I'm trying to do a very TV, and what I imagine it to sound like back then is more radio.
TV-friendly voice.
Yeah.
A little radio voice.
A little more radio than I'm expected, yeah.
When you tour, do you have to do those morning radio shows?
I always have to do morning radio. Actually, here in Boston, I had and I can look it up. I can't remember. It was yesterday. It was a very, like, it was an old guy and then two younger
WRR. Was it
yeah.
Lauren and Wally?
Yes, Lauren and Wally. Yes. So so I did that, and I get in there, and they've got this older couple on who they had clearly just finished talking about the royal wedding, which just ended, by the way.
Yes,
for the listeners who want to archive this in your brains. Yep. The royal, oh my god,
it's royal wedding day. We're both glowing.
Oh, we're just glowing from
you
wasting 4 hours of our lives.
Hear the hats we're wearing.
Oh. Or they should hear you.
Yeah.
Because they're made out of human ears, but humans who died.
They are. It's a tiger force hat, but you know, it
exactly
makes sense.
Exactly. The tiger signed a waiver before it died. But no, the and all I did was go, I wonder why does anyone want to watch, spend 4 hours a day watching the royal wedding? And the older woman went, because it's a real life fairy tale.
Yeah.
And I was like, okay. And then the guy asked where I was from, and I said New Orleans, and he goes, what a cesspool. And it was a thing of like, I don't know if you're trying to rile me up, but like, that's just what. And I was like, you're from Boston. You're calling New Orleans a cesspool?
That's your answer.
They're the same city
in
many ways.
That's
what
we do here. There's like I always joke that you wouldn't think there'd be enough shoulders for all the chips here, but people are willing to take on multiples. And it's just like a whole, you have so many people who never left here, which is fine. But they justify it by saying, I'm never leaving. Everywhere else is a fucking dump.
It's just like, no matter what it is. Like, you could have been like, well, I grew up in the penthouse of the Luxor in Las Vegas. Fucking cesspool.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Vancouver, Canada. Ah, right. Jesus, a bunch of hippies with free healthcare pussies.
Fucking Maui, what? Hawaii. Yeah. Yeah, I hope you love your fucking black sand paradise and anywhere. Don't get stabbed by a fucking Japanese prisoner of war. Like, what are you talking about? This doesn't make sense.
From New Zealand. Yeah, I hope you don't get swallowed by one of them freaking Mordor elephants.
Fucking Lord of the Rings is going to come to your house and fucking rob you blind of all your fucking cars.
Why would I ever move there and get freaking, that little guy running around going to steal my fucking wedding ring? And then the old lady's blaming me for going around and buying her back, which I'm not.
Fucking hairy footed freaks hanging out with freaking beardy gays.
But for some reason they know. They don't know shit about New Zealand, but they know that movie was produced there.
Yeah. I know everything about that. I never seen it, and I never fucking will.
What am I, a fucking dweeb?
My favorite thing about Boston people is that because they're so obsessed with Ireland, which you may or may not have noticed, they will defend any band from Ireland as being cool. So I've literally heard the most towniest of towny guys be like, the fucking cores are pretty good, though. Like, the girls are, like, really hot, and they're, like, they kind of can fucking rock.
They can,
like,
you know what I mean? No matter who it is. The fucking, that one song. I mean, come on, dude, the Dropkick Murphys. Like, aren't they from here?
Yeah, they are.
Yeah, there you go.
But they're just like, you two, like, if you two was not from Ireland, every dude from here would be like, what a bunch of, they're so
oh,
queer.
Oh, yeah, dude.
But they're like, fucking you two is my favorite band
ever. You know, I don't mind that they just automatically come with iPhone or iTunes, you know?
It's kind of nice, you know?
They got like, fucking balls to just do that.
This is fucking badass. So is there like a a New Orleans version of that?
Well, actually, that's I talk about this on stage, but I do a New Orleans accent is very. And actually, I gave a local publication shit because they printed.
Oh, your punchline, right?
Yeah, they printed the punch. I was like, "What are you doing?" But it's true. Like, a New Orleans accent does just sound like a sedated New Jersey accent. But the one thing both cities have in common is when I travel, and you tell someone where they're from. The person cannot help themselves.
Yeah.
But do an accent.
Oh, yeah.
Do what they think the accent is.
Yeah.
You know? They can't fucking. Oh, Boston, you parked the car in the Harvard Yard, you fucking.
It's like, never accurate.
Jesus. Yeah. Say, well, New Orleans. Like, oh, New Orleans? You got a gumbo? Like, I got a gumbo. You know what a gumbo is? Yeah, I just got one on me right now.
Rumalad.
Yeah. Rumalad, yeah.
Well, they start doing like the water boy.
Oh, dude. Always. And the problem is that, like, I actually think that's one of Adam Sandler's better films.
Yeah, I would agree.
And it's annoying that it's like, oh, but he's fucking.
Couldn't it be said anywhere else?
Just anywhere else.
Is there.
And yes, it could have.
Is there a TV show or movie that is quintessentially New Orleans?
No. That's nothing. That's something I talk about a lot. Like, no show has captured it. Like, even Tremé. And Tremé had its season or two where it was like, oh, okay, this is. And then all of a sudden it started going off into like, but no one, people don't just have crawfish boils at lunch.
You know? I ate myself 2,700 crawfish at lunch
today.
Yeah,
it's just like people don't. And then like there was so many things about that show where it was like, this is a great show that you could also set in any city.
Right.
Because they, in some scenes, went to New Orleans where it's like, oh, just everyone also plays an instrument.
Why are you wearing Mardi Gras masks?
Exactly.
It's August.
But then also, exactly, yeah. And Mardi Gras masks. That's the other thing. But then the other things, were, then the other parts were like, this is a great show about anywhere else.
Have you seen Frank's Place?
What's that?
It was a show that Tim Reed was in, who was Venus Flytrap on WKRP in Cincinnati.
No.
And the premise of the show was he's a Providence lawyer whose dad owns a restaurant in New Orleans and dies and leaves him this restaurant. So he goes down there to like basically wrap it up and sell it, but then ends up running it.
Right.
And I mean, I don't know how accurate it is for New Orleans, but it's a really good show.
Frank's Restaurant?
Frank's Place, it's called. Yeah, it was one season, single camera, shot on film sitcom.
What?
I think 88 or 89 on CBS. It won an Emmy. It got canceled and won an Emmy after it was canceled, but it's really good. I don't know how New Orleansy it is.
You see, I would love to get a whole Like, there should be a channel, because it's everything's becoming so niche. There should be a channel dedicated to just, like, one season greats.
Oh, yeah.
That's all it is. It's just, they were just playing.
Trio used to do that.
Yeah.
When Trio was around, they had a thing every week called Brilliant But Canceled, and they'd show, like, See? Really short-run series. But
they should show them for a year, and then, depending on the popularity of the viewership, reboot it, or pick it, like, yeah. Airwolf.
Oh, I mean, Jen Michael Vincent's a mess right now. I think he could do it. I wouldn't want him flying my plane.
Yeah, yeah.
yeah, you have a robot. Oh my God, Ernest Borgnine.
Yeah, yeah.
like a cyborg.
Or they just Borgnine. If they do the reboot, they just have to cast like, and you, whoever that actor is like, oh, so I'm the new Ernest Borgnine.
Yeah.
And that's what the American.
But I'm 35 years old. Nope.
Nope.
You're Ernest
You're
Borgnine.
Ageless.
Yeah.
I saw that show for the first time in Australia like a month ago. It was just on Australian TV. And I was like, what is this TV show premise? Oh, luckily he's just got that helicopter.
Yeah. It's Knight Rider helicopter.
Yeah. Luckily.
There was Knight Rider everything. There was Knight Rider boat. Which was
really?
Oh yeah, there was Knight Rider motorcycle, there was Knight Rider robot, like there was just every possible vehicle they tried to rip off as a Knight Rider ripoff. What?
Yeah, that's funny. I love that. As soon as you started saying that, I'm like, oh yeah,
yeah,
Knight Rider. It's like let's just keep. What else can we make talk to us?
Skateboard?
Yeah.
unicycle? What's I don't
gonna,
know.
What if we get a kid who's got a, yeah, you got a fucking Knight Rider, one of them little kick scooters.
Did you ever see Turbo Teen?
You are not the first person to bring this up to me, but no, I've never seen it.
It's the best. It's
Is
the
it
best.
A robot teen?
It was created by Jack Kirby, actually. Believe it or not.
That guy's done a lot. Wait.
Well, he was in the 80s. He was really down on his luck because Marvel fucked him. So a lot of guys that grew up loving his stuff hired him to do cartoons.
Because he was, let me just make sure I'm right, my headspace. He was, Jack Kirby co-created most of the characters with Stan Lee, right?
And actually created. Stan Lee really
just kind of ran with it. Yeah.
But I mean, he created the Fantastic Four. He created Captain America.
Okay.
I mean, Kirby, Darkseid, when Thanos is a ripoff of Darkseid. Like, so much of our current pop culture is directly created by Jack Kirby.
Wow.
But towards the end of his life, he was pitching shows for Ruby Spears. And he worked on Thundar the Barbarian.
Thundar.
In the year 1995. The Earth splits in two. but he created a show called Turbo Teen, and it was because Transformers was huge, Knight Riders was huge, and Teen Wolf was huge.
Okay.
So they made a show that was that. And it was about a kid who walks in on an experimental, drives his car accidentally into an experimental laser and gets fused with his car. So now whenever he gets hot, he turns into a car.
That's fucking. And I hope it was all just as like disturbing as it would be in real life. It hurts.
Well, his face gets really wide, and then there's like a shot of just his ass getting huge, turned into a car. it's funny too, because their definition of what is hot, like what getting hot means, was very broad. So like sometimes it would be like, put him in a sauna. He's in a Mexican jail in one, and a guy in the Mexican jail happens to have a burrito in his pocket and gives him a spicy burrito that turns him into a thing.
And
a
the
girl
fact
kisses
that
the him.
Kid don't eat the goddamn burrito.
Pocket burrito in a Mexican
pocket
jail.
Burrito in a Mexican jail.
I don't have kids, but I think that's one
like first
word
rule.
Of wisdom.
First rule.
You find yourself in a Mexican jail.
No pocket burritos.
A guy's going to try to give
because
you a burrito.
Because it sounds like a dick.
Pocket
you just
burrito?
Blew a guy.
It certainly does. When you were a kid, did your parents...
And that's a different type of hot right there.
Yeah, absolutely.
Blowing a guy
blowing
in a Mexican jail.
That's
right?
What they do too. They're like, we need him turned into the car, quick.
We need to get him turned on. Let's explore ways of hot.
Dios mio. Take this siesta.
Did
was
my
there
parents,
like
what?
Some weird urban legend stuff that your parents would tell you? Like my parents were always like, at school... People will give you things that look like candy, and it's LSD. Don't take it. Like, it'd be that kind of stuff.
Oh, dude, yeah. There was definitely the, like, because there was definitely the, I mean, I remember the first one was don't eat unwrapped anything at Halloween.
Yes.
Like, don't even accept it if you can, but, or if you do accept it, give it to an adult.
Yep.
Which is a thing of, like, I can remember being like, well, here's adult, excuse me, like, stranger adult.
What was the worst thing you got on Halloween?
Dude, I remember getting mad when people gave me money.
Pennies?
I remember like dollar bills.
Really?
Yeah, they're just like they just a guy would just hand out dollars to certain kids.
Dance for him.
And it was like, this is bullshit.
Yeah, it'd be funny if you only like three kids show up at the door and he's like, penny, penny, dollar. I'm like, like, doesn't give everyone the same thing.
Hey, look, we got a thing. Yeah,
he tried.
You know, I come over once a day. I try the candies, if you know what I mean.
Well, it's funny because there's been not a single instance of a child being poisoned by Halloween candy.
Oh, seriously?
There was one instance, but it was the parent who had done it as like a Munchausen syndrome thing.
Okay, yeah.
But regardless, like, and a lot of hospitals would run a thing where like, kids, bring your candy to the hospital and we'll x-ray it for you. And I'm like, you're going to bombard this with radiation? That's better than a thing that never happened.
It sounds like, this candy's got bones.
Yeah.
Holy shit, this isn't candy at all.
There's a whole fish in there.
Yes. This is a fucking alien life form. He was about to eat it.
My grandfather told me that Butterfingers were actual fingers when I was a kid. That was big.
Yeah. I didn't really, like, it's real weird. Like, I grew up, I wish I had more interactive adults in my life, if that makes sense.
Were you kind of a free range kid?
Yeah, but I was also like, and it's nothing against my, no dig against my uncles and aunts and even my parents, but they were all very of the, like, kids play over there, adults play over here.
Seen and not heard kind of thing?
And just, be good. We're watching out for you. We're making sure you're not fucking, you know, fingering each other or...
Let me know if you're bleeding.
Exactly. There's nobody's got a weapon, but stay over there.
Yeah.
So it's because there was like, I mean, I can remember pay-per-view fights. Those were the nights where like my uncles would come over and it'd be like, I like Holyfield. I like Douglas. And just then then after a few Coors banquets, the real shit starts coming out.
Oh, yeah.
You're like, whoa, I didn't know you could say that.
Adults?
That many times
like
in a row? Yeah.
I'm kind of envious of you for that because I had what you've just described all the time. My uncles would be like, Thanksgiving, and they're like, what are you fucking looking at? Arm wrestle. And then they'd like smash glass over each other's heads and shoot each other with Roman candles.
Wait, what'd you say to me?
Yeah.
Can I take your shirt off?
Think you're a fucking big shot?
Yeah.
Just because you got a job now?
Yeah, that kind of thing. Oh, okay. Guess who started his own company and now thinks he can lip off to his older brother?
Oh, my father's brother, who was younger, much bigger than him, would always, my dad worked for Raytheon.
Raytheon?
Which is a civil defense company. Like they made the Patriot missile.
Okay.
And, you know, like my dad was in the Navy. But my uncle would always be like, you fucking yuppie. Because my dad had like speakers.
Yeah,
you know
exactly.
What I mean? Like that kind of thing. It was like,
oh, you got a belt.
Yuppie. Yeah. Did you have siblings?
Yeah. I got three younger siblings.
Okay. So you're the oldest.
Yeah. So we were all as tight as we could be growing up, but we were so... Age-wise, there was such gaps.
Brothers?
Like, only one brother, two sisters. But like, my little brother's 14 and a half years younger than me.
Wow.
So like, we didn't even become like, I wouldn't say we started really connecting as, like, brothers until I was like 30.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Like, when you were the age your uncles were when they were like, sit over there.
I was basically an uncle to him his whole life.
Yeah.
Until he was like... Then I started going home and just being like, Mom, I'm just going to take Daniel for a day.
Yeah.
Don't worry. I'm not going to let him do anything stupid. I'm not going to take him to a strip club, which I totally did.
Nice.
You know, because he wanted to go and he was very like, to my surprise, and very like, I was going to say to my pleasure, but that sounds disgusting. But like to my like, I was like, oh, good.
You're proud of him.
He wasn't like a weird, like, look at these bitches.
Yeah.
He was very just like, huh, and very like polite.
Yeah.
And very just like, should I give money? Yeah. I'm like, yeah, give a couple, here's money.
Pretend it's Halloween. Give him a dollar.
Give him a dollar.
were you like, oh, I'm going to do for my little brother like what I wished adults did for me when I was a kid? I mean, specific to the strip club. But
well, the strip club was something like... You know, he was 17. He was just like, I want to go inside one of those.
Is that a huge, like, cultural thing in New Orleans?
Nah, I mean, it's
or
not.
Or just
it's,
for you.
It's, yeah, exactly. It is a massive, it's a presence in New Orleans.
Yeah.
And to act as if it isn't a thing as a young man you want to do is just ridiculous. So
I've only been once to a strip club.
I don't go, I don't frequent.
I think you might have been there that year. I did Bridgetown, and they do like that, like, Bridgetown strip club crawl.
The strip club, the daytime.
Yeah.
Well, Portland has an interesting thing with strip clubs because it's got the most per capita.
Right.
But also, they're like union.
Yeah. And they're all like, I mean, I don't know how they are normally, but I literally walked into the first one. I was there for 5 minutes and I left. It's the only time I've been in a strip club.
Yeah.
But it was really small. It was like a little diner in your town that had like
a naked woman.
Yeah. Yeah. It was like, okay.
It's really what it's like, man. I mean, New Orleans is a little more of that classic strip club model, but like, you know, I took him to one. We were there for probably an hour, and then we left, and it was like, all right, cool, that's got that out of the system.
Right.
And then like I took him to bars if he wanted to drink, you know, but he mainly just wanted to like be out in the city.
Yeah, and check the stuff off his list.
Yeah, and now he's, I think, I don't think it had much to do with me, but you know, he's in his 20s now, and he has like a real career and stuff.
So you basically rumspringed him.
Pretty much. I felt like no one ever, when I was his age, I never had anyone to be like, hey, let's talk about some of these things you're experiencing now.
Right.
And let me tell you how you should be, or if what you're thinking is fucked up.
Right. It's that was normal. My main thing. Lean into it, and I'll kind of correct you or like put you on the path.
Exactly. Like,
right.
How do you feel about, because I remember when I took him, he came to New York when he was 18, and we were walking around Washington Square Park, and there's that big arch, you know, in Washington Square Park.
Mm-hmm.
And there was, we walked up, and there was a gay wedding, two guys getting married. And we walk up on it, and you know, I assumed it was going to happen like this because, you know, New Orleans is a pretty progressive minded city.
Yeah.
But we walk, I'm like, oh, how's he going to react to, you know, two gay guys getting married? And he just is like, ah, oh yeah, that's beautiful. You can just get married outside here. Cool.
What an archway.
Like, his big thing was, how expensive do you think this is?
Right.
That was it. He was just like, this is crazy. Anyway, like, it didn't. And I was like, when I was his age, I don't think I was definitely more fucking open-minded than most. But I was also, the 90s, I'd have at least still been like, oh, look, a gay wedding.
Yeah.
You know?
That's a novelty.
Look at that.
Yeah.
You know, two guys.
Yeah.
Congratulations.
Cool. Yeah.
You know?
You guys are doing it.
You're doing it. Or like, who's the wife? Who's the husband? Right, doesn't really matter. Right. I'm just curious.
When you moved to New York for stand-up, was that the first time you'd been there?
No, I went a couple of years before I moved there, just like to visit one of my friends who moved there after school, after college, just to see it for the first time. And he lived on the upper west, like 115th and Broadway. So like the first thing I saw, I remember I took a train into Penn Station. He met me there. We got on what's now the 123, but then was the 19. And we went up to, like, I think the stop was 115th and Broadway. I remember walking up the subway steps and being like, oh my God, I'm about to get an eye full in New York.
Yeah.
And then you come out and it's like, the Upper West Side.
Some trees.
Which is very just neighborhoody. Yeah.
I just picture it's all Matthew Broderick, Rick in a sweater just drinking coffee.
Yeah, exactly. Or it was actually all that like Friends Diner.
Right.
That's where that
Central
was.
Central Perk.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. But it was just very like, oh, okay, New York.
What did you think it would be like? What movies, because you're more of a movie guy than a TV guy, like what movies set your expectation for what New York would be like?
You know what movie, I don't know why it stuck with me so hard, was the film Eyes Wide Shut, which isn't an old movie, but he's in the village the whole time.
Yeah, yeah.
That and Rounders.
Okay.
Which, because they're all, I mean, that movie now.
There's a lot in like Brighton Beach and stuff, because it's all like Russian gangsters and Rounders.
No,
right?
But possibly, but a majority of that movie, they're in the East. They set it in the East Village.
Okay, okay.
So, you know, because they're going to Turkish bathhouses and.
Right, right.
You know, but yeah, it's, that movie's not that disaggregate, but I mean, the first time I went to specifically like the East Village, Alphabet City areas, it was like, oh, wow.
This is New York.
Yeah, now we're talking.
Yeah, yeah.
But even now I'm like, oh, those areas are kind of yuppied out a little bit.
Yeah.
It happened. It's never, we can't fight it.
No,
they come for us all.
It's good and bad too. Yeah. Like where we're sitting right now, this literally like on this spot was where you would dump bodies.
Yeah.
Like this was
the Whitey Bulger.
Yeah, this was
body dumping.
There was a show called Spencer for Hire that they shot here, which actually had a spinoff series set in New Orleans, weirdly, called
really?
A Man Called Hawk.
Really?
Yeah, yeah.
God damn, you do know a lot about TV shows.
I love my TV.
Yeah.
But every shootout they shot on that show was right here. In like, all this neighborhood.
Right where we're sitting.
Yeah, there used to be about 40 feet from where we're sitting, which we're in kind of a weird side room here by Laugh Boston.
Yeah.
There was a punk rock club called The Channel.
Okay.
And it was, it started as like a disco, and then it was just, this area became so desolate that there was nothing else around here. It was just a dumpy punk rock club surrounded by parking lots. And it was rough, and the cops didn't come over here, so they just let anyone in. And it was, that's what was here. It's so weird that now we have this.
And now it's a giant convention center.
Which is probably better.
Probably better than a murder.
Yeah.
Than a murder patch.
Yeah.
But at the same time, I mean, I question, because ultimately, like, what's being murdered aside from people?
Yeah.
By the presence of places like this, you know?
Just get a brick, a few eggs to make that omelet.
You know what I mean? Yeah. And then once you eat the omelet, you start to wonder, was it worth it?
Well, it's funny, too, because I think we have a false impression, too, that, like, all the prostitutes and the drugs and stuff is gone. But it's just moved to, like, Lowell and Lawrence, which are, like, 45 minutes north and are just economically depressed, you know?
Or they just bring in new drugs.
Yeah.
And hire-end prostitutes.
Yeah.
You know, because that's...
Which that's nice that they upped the class.
Yeah. Like, when you walk around Times Square and you see what it is now versus... And you hear what it was. And you're like, but which one was really worse?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Because this was just like M&M buildings and tourist vans and...
Guy Fieri restaurants.
Hard Rock Cafe spinoffs and like all this bullshit and people dressed like, you know, Spider-Man and taking pictures, but they cost money. And it's just all this like, it's all this just like, look, capitalism. Whereas before it was like, yeah, drugs and porno stores and hookers. But there was also like... But you went in there and you saw the seedy underbelly of society.
Yeah.
And you got something from it.
And it had a place to go. Like, I used to hang around in what they called in Boston the combat zone, which was like our 42nd Street. It was like our Times Square. And I shouldn't have been hanging out there, but I would go there because that's where they showed the movies I wanted to watch.
Yeah.
And, you know, I think it made me a more well-rounded person.
Right.
But I'm sure there were kids who got, like, stabbed there.
Sure. You
know? So I lucked out. But at the same time, yeah, I don't know where... The Boston that is now is a totally alien landscape to me. Like, not a single place I used to hang out exists anymore.
Wow.
Not a single one.
Wow.
And to the point where they've, like... Not even that it's like now a massage place or like now a frozen yoga place. Like it's been torn to the ground.
Oh, like new building.
Yeah, new building. Like not even a vestigial piece of it is left. And it's every record store, every club, everything. And it's really weird.
And that part is like,
Yeah.
Fuck, though.
Which is why I love watching old movies set in Boston in the 70s and 80s for that reason. And I feel sad that you don't have a New Orleans thing like it. Like, has New Orleans kind of changed like that? Or is it...
You see, New Orleans, like, fortunately, a lot of the architecture of New Orleans is so... I mean, and it shocks me what you're telling me here, because I was going to say it's so old, and Boston's roughly the same age, if not older. So it's like... But a lot of that New Orleans architecture is, like, untouchable.
Yeah.
So they can't just bulldoze certain areas down. They have to just sort of revamp them. And certainly, there are definitely areas of that city that are very, like, you know, when they built the casino and when they, the Marigny, which is now like the Brooklyn, you know, Echo Park, Brooklyn of New Orleans, like that area before was like the working class / dangerous.
Right.
You don't go down. You went to one bar down there. Or you go, and you were 9 times out of 10 meeting a guy to buy Molly or Coke from.
Right.
You know, and now it's like, you've got, you know, it's all been completely.
But some of that's Katrina too, I imagine. Like some of it was kind of enforced.
No, I mean that was one of those areas that's why. What's super fucking funny? Not if there's anything funny about devastating hurricane, it is that when it happened, I remember, and afterwards you had all these like evangelical psychos on TV just preaching about how
God's
wrath to destroy the bigotry. Yeah. I mean, not the bigotry that I wish they would say
the
that.
The sin
and the debauchery of the homosexual. And then you're like, all of that took place in the French Quarter, the one neighborhood that was completely unharmed.
Yeah.
Unharmed.
So if anything, the message from God is, you guys should be fucking, and if you don't, I'm going to kill you.
Like I did all those people in coastal Mississippi.
Yeah.
Because I wiped them fuckers out. Yeah.
So put on a dress, put on some makeup, and go to Freaknik.
What are you, a guy? Not tonight.
Yeah.
All right, get in there. You're just a pansexual.
New Orleans, man.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, it's very strange that just how the things change, and that's part of the reason I do love this kind of stuff.
Yeah,
you know, because we have an issue from
1978.
November 18th to the 24th. You were just formed.
Born.
Yeah.
Yeah, I was born November 16th, 78, and I was like, what happened that week in TV?
Yeah, and it's. But you said you weren't really watching a lot of stuff when you were a kid. Like, you kind of were only watching stuff like the 90s.
I grew up, like, my parents, I was, like, telling you, my parents, I was a cable kid, and we just watched movies.
Latchkey kid?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So, like, we just watch movies. Come home, watch movies.
Cinemax, late, HBO. Movie,
just like, what's on HBO? What's on Cinemax? But that was back when cable was seriously, like, 19 channels, maybe top.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, you had like four different movie. Yeah, the Movie Channel, you know, yeah. Cinemax, Showtime, and HBO.
And all of those, none of them really were doing original programming yet.
No, HBO was the first one.
HBO was the first Netflix.
Yeah.
Except they didn't mail you anything.
They started in the mid-70s just to show sporting events.
Oh, I didn't know that. I didn't know that.
And a lot of those networks did.
Home box office.
Yeah.
There it is.
But HBO started producing. The first stuff they produced was like comedy specials, which they did a lot for like, what's his name?
Carlin.
Before Carlin, it was Robert Klein.
Oh, okay.
So he did some ones, then Carlin and Gallagher. But then the first original show they did was called First and Ten with O.J. Simpson. And
really?
it was a football sitcom.
Really? See, that sounds actually kind of interesting.
It's actually pretty good.
Yeah, yeah.
Delta Burke was in a season. It was really funny.
How many seasons did they do?
They did like 7 seasons.
What?
Yeah. But they were short seasons. But still. And no one remembers that show.
No.
And then they did Dream On and Tales from the Crypt.
Dream On is the one that everybody, first, yeah. Because they always showed boobs.
Oh, yeah. Even if it didn't make any sense to the story.
Yeah, it's like, oh, there's boobs again. What was that show even about?
It was about a guy named, it was Brian Benben played a New York literary agent.
Right.
Who was newly divorced, and that was the basic premise. So he was constantly dating.
Right.
So that's why there was boobs in every episode.
Dream On, yes.
But it was a decent show. There's some funny episodes in that.
And then Arliss.
Arliss, ooh. Yeah.
Yeah, buddy.
Have you ever met Robert Wool?
No. Is he from Boston?
No, he's a California guy, and he's in a movie called Hollywood Nights with Tony Danza and Michelle Pfeiffer. That's like an American Graffiti ripoff, and he plays a character called New Bomb Turk, who's like he's like the John Belushi in the movie.
Right, right.
But it's just him mooning everyone for like 90 minutes.
It's just. New Bomb Turk's here.
Oh boy. Yeah,
here comes some ass.
Everyone I've ever talked to talks like he's the biggest asshole on earth, but I'm like, I really? Yeah, I don't know why. And I don't know if that's even true.
Also, actually, now that I'm thinking about it, there were a lot of topless women in Arliss as well.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
A lot of topless women in those early HBO.
Yeah.
It wasn't until they got to The Sopranos where they were like, maybe we don't need.
They felt like it was their differentiator. They were like, we can swear and show boobs, so we're going to do it.
True.
A friend of mine worked on Dream On, and I asked him about that, and he said John Landis was a producer on Dream On, and he went, John really liked casting.
Jesus.
I was like,
yeah,
great.
He did.
He fucking did. So did you paid for the cable? You have like a black box satellite dish? You weren't.
No, we didn't. I mean, the satellite dish.
Yeah.
God, remember that?
The
yeah.
divorced dad, yeah. friend of your uncle, had a satellite dish. Everyone knew one guy.
Oh, yeah.
Usually had a waterbed, too.
And it was like a massive satellite dish in the yard. That, like, you'd have to like, we're going to move the dish.
Yep. It'd be next to their above ground pool.
Yeah. And it would take, it would move, and it'd be a whole new set of chat. Jesus Christ, yep. Remember that? Yeah.
You could get, the coolest thing about those like 70s, 80s satellite dishes was you could get weird stuff you weren't supposed to see. Like you could get news feeds, like, because that's how they used to send raw footage to the other news stations. They'd basically send it on the satellite, and they'd record it on their end. So you'd get all that kind of stuff. You'd get like weird military stuff, foreign things. Like, you never knew what weird stuff you could pull out of a satellite dish. And it was great.
I can remember being at my friend's house when looking through channels and stuff on the satellite dish, and there were times where it just looked like the Matrix feed.
Yeah.
Where it was just like, what? How can you tell what a channel is on that? Yeah.
It's overload. I don't know what I'm getting.
Let's just choose this. Yeah. Oh, my God. It's Dream On, the boob.
It's Emmanuel.
Oh, yeah. Jesus, the porn.
Yeah. Oh, the Skinamax late night stuff.
Skinamax late nights. Yeah. The Red Shoe Diaries.
There's a... one of my favorite jokes of Dennis Miller, of all people.
Oh, yeah.
Was that...
he had one or two.
Do you know what he used to say HBO stood for?
No.
Hey, Beastmaster's on. His Beastmaster. Beastmaster, Hot Dog the Movie, Just One of the Guys, and Better Off Dead.
Better Off.
Nonstop on HBO.
Hey, Beastmaster's on. That's fucking... There you go. Where's that Dennis Miller?
I know. I miss him. There was a movie called Big Man on Campus they used to show all the time about... a hunchback that lives in the tower in like a Notre Dame type okay. school that they, you know, they try to like Eliza Doolittle him.
Yummy, dude.
And he says his name is Bob Baluga Ooga Ooga.
Seriously?
Yeah.
Who played that hunchback?
I don't know. It was the guy that wrote the movie. It was on HBO nonstop.
You know what HBO is also good for? Like the Dunstan Checks-ins.
Oh, yes.
Of the world.
Yep.
You like, because I'd never, ever heard of that movie.
Yeah. And it was Why like, would you?
Oh, sure, I'll watch this. I'm trying to go to sleep.
There was two Anthony Michael Hall movies they always showed in the late 90s. One was called Hail Caesar, I think, and he played like a rock and roller. And one was called The Gnome Named Norm.
Jesus.
Anthony Michael Hall. And it was just nonstop. And all the Barbarian Brother movies.
Yeah.
Think Big and Twin.
You know, it's weird when you're growing up and shit and you watch like, or you look back on like a career of like an Anthony Michael Hall or an act like that, and you're like, why did they do so many dumb movies?
Yeah.
And being kind of, you know, and being in the business now, you realize like, oh, because you like...
got to make a living.
Got to make a fucking living. And you're like, sure, and I'll take another...
Yeah.
I'll do another Barbarina Comes to Life or whatever.
That's the thing I always say about people, especially since I've been doing the show, like, and having grown up very blue collar,
yeah.
I've learned that acting... is probably the most blue collar business I've ever encountered,
like just,
because it's a constant yeah. hustle.
And, yeah,
and it's worse because, like, if you were a carpenter on a fancy building, people don't go, "You got money? You worked on that fucking $1 billion building."
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
Yeah.
They're like, I saw you in a movie. You can't work at this hotel.
Yeah, exactly. It's like,
you can't just go get a regular job after.
It's like,
that.
You was in those three movies. I know you got how many houses? Yeah. Two per movie.
And you wanna work here as a busboy?
Yeah,
and you're
yeah.
I need some money, man.
It's like the fucking. Or it's also like, you could be a working actor for 30 years, and there's people who still don't know your name.
Yeah.
You know, they still like just, but you know the face.
Yeah.
You know the guy. I mean, I know Sam Rockwell recently did a. I mean, I adore Sam Rockwell, but people like geeked out about that his monologue, and I was like, "What monologue?"
Yeah,
he came out, said who he was, and then did like a very sloppy dance number.
Yeah,
and it was just like, and that was a monologue, and that's where we're at now with monologues. But
well, that's I mean SNL. I was a hardcore SNL nerd till about 2000, and then I just stopped watching.
Yeah,
but because there's a saying that the best season of SNL, there's a definitive answer. People argue about it, but there is a definitive answer.
Yeah,
and it's whatever season was on when you were 12.
Yeah,
I always knew the pattern. Like when they thought the host wasn't funny,
yeah,
they'd do one of three things for the monologue. They'd have them take questions from the audience.
Yeah.
They'd do a thing where there was like a crawl up across the screen, like saying the opposite of whatever they were saying, or something like that.
Yeah.
Or they'd have them sing and do a song. And
yeah.
it was always one of those three things.
And there was an SNL monologue once. It was Ben Affleck, and Gwyneth Paltrow came out of nowhere, and I was like, "Oh, hi, Gwyneth," and they just started talking. And the joke became about winning the Oscar, which she had won for Shakespeare in Love.
Yep.
But he had also won for Best Original Screenplay for Good Will Hunting.
Yeah.
And he was like, I've won one as well. And she was like, yeah, for writing. And that was like supposed to be the joke.
Yeah.
Where it's like, yeah, you mean the thing that's harder?
The thing that you wouldn't have an Oscar for if someone didn't write the thing you were in?
Exactly. If someone didn't write the thing that you were in that's based off of a guy who just wrote?
You know who was a big writer? Was that Shakespeare?
Yeah, yeah. When the guy who fell in love with your character that you won an Oscar for playing that he wrote.
You know what else? You wouldn't have an Oscar if love didn't exist.
Yeah.
You wouldn't have an Oscar if Shakespeare didn't exist with his writing. So, yeah.
Yeah, it's like, but it was also just like a, I remember, and I was like in high school when that happened, and still being like, yeah, but writing's probably harder.
Yeah. You kind of need that, right?
Yeah, yeah. Why would you? And that should have been like, oh, yeah, you won one for writing.
Yeah.
And then
the joke is the opposite of what you've done.
It was, there were so many. Yeah, but I mean, I do remember in real time watching that, like, Matt Foley sketch.
Yes.
In real time. Like, yep. Freshman in high school, just like, oh, this is the funniest thing I've
David Spade cracking
seen.
Up. Yeah. And it was, what's her name from Married with Children? Christina Applegate. Was hosting.
Yeah.
Did you, they must have had you audition for SNL since you've been in New York, right?
I have not gone in and auditioned. I've only filmed myself auditioning.
Yeah.
And, like, at this point, like, it's something you just accept about where you are at, about life. It's like they're not looking for guys like me right now.
Yeah, that's like a when you're 25.
Yeah,
and you're I'll go down. And then you hear, and then you know people that worked on it, and they're like, it's the worst thing I ever did in my life.
Oh yeah, they're like, or people who you know, who are, where it's like, they were on for one season.
Yeah.
And now they're not on anymore. And though they've moved on with their careers, it still haunts them.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
It haunts them.
Yeah. It's, you know? They're Stockholm from it a lot of times.
Yeah, yeah.
So let's dive in here. November. Oh, yeah, sure. Sorry, I will go on tangents all day. That is my...
That was a tangent, right?
My stock in trade is tangents. November 18th, 1978 is the Saturday here. As soon as I open this, there's a weekend special.
Which one is that one?
It's called Soup for President.
And oh, I missed that.
It's Friendship versus Courtship. Luther Soup Vinson is running for class president, but Rob, his best friend and campaign manager, seems to have a crush on the opposite candidate. Will Rob vote for friendship or for love?
I mean, being that was in the late 70s, we know the answer.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, we know.
Yeah. Did you ever run for a class office?
I didn't. No, I was too shy, and like I was a kid. I was a quiet, shy kid. I was a very, like, I mean, I wasn't a dark, like, fuck off.
Right. You weren't a brooder.
No, but I was definitely like a, sure, guys, hi.
Yeah.
I wasn't like, people are like, you're a comedian, weren't you the class clown? I'm like, no, I was more the, like, skipping school, smoking weed with three of my friends in the woods clown.
Oh, fuck up.
Yeah, yeah. Fuck up.
Yeah, no, that's what most people who go into comedy that I know later is like, we didn't get it out of our system in high school.
Exactly.
We were planning it.
I'm just returning this text because it keeps fucking texting.
Oh, no problem.
But go ahead.
I've also noticed here that since this is 1978, like, Star Wars has permeated everything, and there's an ad in here for a night of country music things. So it's Hee Haw's Honeys, Dolly Parton, Nashville Music, Pop Goes Country, but for no discernible reason, they've done the ad in the style of Star Wars.
Oh yeah, look at that. Superstation.
Superstation, Saturday Country Night with like a satellite dish and a spaceship. It has nothing to do with anything on
it. And it's interesting that you look and see that almost 40 years later, it's like, oh, it's still permeated.
Yeah.
Everything.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, everything. And this is a year after the first one even came out.
Just a year.
And it's still on everything.
Yeah.
So would you go with at 8 o'clock on the Saturday?
At 8 o'clock, I went with Julia Child and Company.
Nice.
Just, and this is almost like this sort of meta, like, weird, is this supposed to be if me now were to, like, time travel and watch these shows?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I definitely would have done that just to see what it looked like in real time. And then Frankie and Annie the second time around.
Wow, you picked some interesting...
Just because they're like classics, Frankie and
Annie.
Yeah, yeah. See what they were up to the second time around.
So, I mean, I love Frankie and Annette. And weirdly, you've picked two things with a Boston connection. So Julia Child was from here. She lived in Cambridge.
I didn't know that, really. Okay.
And they produced all of her stuff in Cambridge at WGBH.
Okay.
The PBS station. And I, as a kid, I used to see her driving her little Volvo around.
Okay.
She was enormous. She was like 6'6". Frankie Avalon lives about a mile from here in the
Seriously?
North End of Boston. Yeah.
Really?
He's an old Italian guy that lives in the North End.
He remembers when, what are you guys doing over there in the wharf? Helmet.
Frankie and Annette's second time around reunites Frankie Avalon and Annette Funicello of the 60s beach party movies in a pilot for a possible comedy series. He's still singing and she's a sorority house mother at a campus near Malibu Beach where they used to frolic some dozen years ago. So weirdly, this sort of this concept they did as the movie Back to the Beach in 1989 with them.
Oh.
I love that movie.
Yeah.
It's really funny.
Was it a TV movie?
You know, it was a theatrical movie.
Really? Okay.
But Frank Mancuso Jr. produced it, who did a lot of TV stuff. And the only other things he produced was the Friday 13th movies. But it's got a lot of 60s TV people in it. Like Bob Denver's in it. Pee Wee Herman's in it. It's really cool. And if you've ever been to Malibu Pier,
Yeah.
Like half of it was shot there.
Yeah.
Which is always really weird.
That's just funny that all he did was Friday the 13th, because it's always like, oh, everybody who's like specific to a genre will have like one
thing they diverged.
And it's like, whoa, buddy.
Yeah.
You know?
Well, Bob Clark that did A Christmas Story.
Yeah.
Everyone's beloved Christmas Story, and he did Porky's.
Yeah.
And the two movies that he was most known for before that were a movie called Black Christmas, which is a horrific horror movie. It's very good, but it's terrifying. And a horror movie called Deranged, which was the first movie to make a movie adapted about Ed Gein.
Really?
Yeah.
Jesus.
Those are the movies he was making before he made Porky's and
Christmas
Story.
It's like Jordan Peele. Everybody's like, oh, Jordan Peele. And then he makes a horror, and it's like...
Yeah.
Yeah. So,
but I have found that so many people who do comedy or like comedy are huge horror nerds too.
Yeah. There's a dark side in there.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah.
And the structure's the same.
Pretty much. Yeah.
It's just different payoff. So
it's different. It's you're getting a different reaction.
I'm going with Battle of the Network Stars.
Battle of the Network Stars?
Because that was, you only saw that once a year. It was your only chance to see, you know, Robert Urich fighting Valerie Bertinelli in a canoe.
Is that what they would do? Was it like physical?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. It was all like physical challenge stuff.
Really?
So ABC, CBS, and NBC resume their war of the athletic field as celebrities from each network participate in swimming relays, football, and obstacle course competitions, baseball dunking, and a tug of war.
Baseball dunking?
Yep.
That was also back, I think, when it was like contracts where it was like, you're an NBC actor.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Everybody knew it.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And there were people who were like, I only watch shows on CBS. Like, people were like hardcore, this is my station.
Not realizing they all hung out in the same.
Yeah, they would never know.
Yeah.
Like, I don't even know. I don't even think I could name actors on a sitcom now. Like, what network they're on, or like.
I
wouldn't associate any.
Yeah, I also don't think like most. Like, these days, I don't think most actors, when you sign up to do a show, would be like exclusive to.
I feel like they don't even know what network it's on, because sometimes you'll have a show that's like produced by Fox but like airs on NBC.
Yeah. Or like how we just saw with Brooklyn 99.
Yeah.
How it's like, as soon as it leaves Fox, it's like, come over here.
That happened rarely. Like the last season of Different Strokes got picked up by ABC from NBC. And you had a couple of shows that did that, but it was really rare. And it was like a big deal. That they were like, well, they moved networks.
Well, they did it. Well, now what?
You can't just do that.
And I love that the idea of like CBS people like, well, I'm not ever.
Yeah.
I'll never.
How dare you?
You realize the company, companies all like they fuck each other's wives probably.
Oh, yeah.
And husbands and eat each other. You know, they go and snort each other's Bolivian.
Yeah.
Bolivian cocaine. Bolivian, isn't that?
Yeah, Bolivian. I think that is. Yeah. It's cocaine that is it's injected into caviar.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly.
Snorted.
And what comes out? Swordfish.
Yeah. I can't, like, well, it's the same. I mean, I'm not a sports guy, but like the people who are like, I can't fucking believe he went to the Yankees. It's like the guy's a freaking mercenary. Like, he was only on this team because they paid him the most at the time. He's not from here. Who cares?
Yeah, that's like a thing with Boston, like. How it's like everybody loves Tom Brady here so much. It's like, yeah, but you know what Tom Brady doesn't love? Owning a home in Massachusetts, because he doesn't.
He's
you know
from
what I mean?
San Francisco.
Yeah, he lives in the fucking Bay Area.
Yeah.
Whenever you see those shots of him and Giselle and their kids, they're not here. They're on a different side of the country.
He just got paid to play for a team that's not even in Boston.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. He brought us five rings. He doesn't care. They're not here. None of his rings are here.
No, they're not. I've worn a Super Bowl ring before. That was pretty exciting.
Really?
Even though I'm not a sports... Like, when I used to work at our local CBS affiliate, the guy who was, like, the head of sales or something used to work for the Pats. So he had two Patriot rings because they'd give them to, like, all the back office people, too.
Yeah, buddy.
And he wore them every day.
Jesus.
And I was like, why are you wearing this? This is insane.
No, it's a fucking... It's an honor.
Yeah. Jesus Christ. Sunday night, what'd you go with?
Sunday night, I went simple. I went to with Greatest Heroes of the Bible.
Yes. Well, we are on a Sunday.
Yeah.
We should watch Greatest Heroes of the Bible.
Yeah. Especially back then, it was like, I'm not going to go to church. So I'll just watch an all-day event.
Were your parents churchy?
No.
Yeah. First of all, I would even say he passed off a documentary called Harpsichord Maker.
Driven
by a passionate interest in early keyboard instruments, Peter Redstone gave up his engineering career to become a builder of harpsichord. I think we should buy the rights and make that movie.
Builder of the struggle.
The builder of harpsichord.
I mean, it is interesting when you think about though, like what they were able. Like you think about the King's Speech and how much everybody loved that movie.
Yeah.
But when you actually pitch that, it's like the guy who helped the king not stutter.
Yep.
For a big war speech.
Here's our money. It's take like, it.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's no dumber than a guy who puts his engineering degree to build harpsichords.
Exactly. And then what happens along the way?
Hayden falls in love.
And what child with what disorder does that harpsichord touch?
Yes, who now becomes president of the United States.
Exactly, yeah.
So you have here's extra weird. On opposite Greatest Heroes of the Bible is a documentary called New Klan, A Heritage of Hate, a profile of modern-day Klansmen. Find them still espousing white supremacy but making sophisticated use of the media to get their message across. This is interesting. The focus is on David Duke, a Louisiana-based Klan leader who follows on the TV talk shows. This is in
1978, bud. Still around.
Yeah.
Still
That's
around.
Insane.
That dude... Like, especially growing up down there, it felt like twice a year David Duke popped up in some capacity.
How is he still getting any airtime?
Because he's
not charming.
No, he's not charming, but it's just that undercurrent of, like, Louisiana is like a lot of the South. Like, New Orleans is an amazing city, and, you know, there's other, Lafayette, Baton Rouge are decent cities. Nothing compared to New Orleans, but, like... Yeah, there's an undercurrent of just like terrified white trash.
Yeah.
You know, and so a guy like David Duke will all, and because he doesn't claim any affiliation to the KKK.
Not anymore. Clearly he does in this documentary.
Back then, yeah. But yeah, he's like, that was, he says it was more of a thing like how Trump did with white supremacists.
Right.
Where
right.
It's like, I don't.
I mean, they like me, but I can't help that.
You know, can I help that they believe in my message?
Right.
Like, no. They believe in your hatred, but the guy just pops up somehow as this like reform leader,
which is so weird because I'm like, you're not well spoken, like you're not like, there's nothing about you that people should be like, yep. We're talking 40 years later, listening to this guy,
David Duke.
You know who my one of my favorite people from New Orleans is?
Who's that?
John Larroquette.
Oh yeah, buddy.
Yeah.
Night Court
is. Still funny.
Yeah.
Larroquette's hilarious on that show.
Harry Anderson was, I mean, when I started doing stand-up in New Orleans, Harry Anderson had just started, like, showing his face. Like,
just moved back?
Yeah, like, popping up and doing, you know. I mean, I guess because when you read about him, it's interesting how he, like, never wanted to be an actor. He was a magician.
Yeah.
And, like, he had just moved back, and then he opened up his Harry Anderson's, like magic and comedy stuff, but only he performed there. That was the weirdest thing. It was just, are they going to start doing comedy? Like mics or what? It's like, nope, just every single night, Harry Anderson.
He's got his TV money and he wants to have a little place to hang out.
Yeah, he just wants to, and then Katrina. But like.
Was that the first person you remember seeing like that was on TV?
That was the first celebrity I remember seeing. Well, not true. In high school, my dad's a caterer. And in high school, he was catering some Tennessee Williams benefit in the quarter, and Alec Baldwin was there.
Oh, nice.
So that was the first, like, celebrity I ever saw in real life was Alec Baldwin. Like,
that
would
have been, like, when The Shadow came out?
That was 1997.
Okay, yeah, when The Shadow came out.
Yeah. I was a high school kid, and I was just like, wow, Alec Baldwin.
Man, The Getaway.
Yeah, exactly. No, that's 100% The Getaway.
Yeah.
You know, like, I didn't, because you remember before 30 Rock, he was just always...
He was an action guy.
I think he was like that Steve McQueen.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like Hunt for Red October. Yeah, like, yeah. Yeah. Was it Hunt for Red October? Or was that? He was, that was one him. Of. Yeah, that was him.
That was
yeah.
him. And you forget that, like, the other two Baldwin. I mean, there are three of them. Daniel Baldwin, I think, is the oldest.
Yep. He was in Vampires, the John Carpenter movie.
Right. But then, like, the two younger Baldwins.
Who I confuse all the time.
Billy.
Yep.
Billy Baldwin. And. I can't remember.
The one that's in Biodome. Is that the one we're forgetting?
The one that's in Stephen Baldwin.
Stephen Baldwin, yeah.
He's in Biodome.
In Threesome.
And in, motherfucker, Kaiser Soze.
Oh, yes, Usual Suspects.
Usual Suspects, yeah. And he's also the worst of them all.
He's the Christian crazy one now, right?
Probably, but he was the one who acted the shit. I thought he was like the worst actor.
He's terrible.
Yeah.
He's the one that thought he was funny.
Yes.
He's like, I'm the wacky one.
And then Billy Baldwin... was the one who thought he was, because he was in that movie Sliver.
Yes.
And that other movie.
Sharon Stone. Sharon,
yeah, and like, there was a time where it was like, oh, no, he was in, I'm sorry, I'm forgetting, Backdraft.
Yes, which was huge. Everyone was like, he's going to be the big star.
He's going to be the Baldwin.
Yeah.
It's like, nope, his brother, still.
Can you imagine that kind of pressure? Like, if your three siblings were like, we're all doing stand-up now.
Dude.
Have they ever expressed interest in that? Christ.
One of my sisters, for a while, she did improv for a little while.
Okay.
Just to, like, if she wanted to do something, and then, like, grew disenchanted with it after a while.
As everyone who does improv should.
Yeah. I encouraged her just to do it just because she wanted to. Just, I was like, hey, if you like it, you never know.
Yeah, and it'll build confidence.
But then there was that moment where it was like, I've thought about that before. Yeah. Like, because that's such a, like, because how, what are the Baldwin brothers' relationships like?
I know, I always see Danny and Bill and Steven fighting on Twitter.
Really?
Daniel Baldwin would be like, shut the fuck up, Steve. You're a fucking idiot. Like, but in front of everybody.
Yeah.
Because they're all like, I think Stephen Baldwin was a huge cokehead and then got born again, like that kind of deal.
Okay, yeah.
So now he's like super conservative, religious, you know, like wears a wooden cross around his neck kind of guy.
Right.
So he argues with them all the time. But I'm like, don't do it in front of everybody.
Dude, that's such a, but there's no family, there's no brotherhood there. You know.
No. No. And you, if your siblings are doing something, you'd be like, I don't want to be the Daniel Baldwin.
Yeah.
Don't make me Daniel.
Yeah. Fuck.
Yeah.
Guys.
Come on, man. Yeah. Heroes of the Bible, who do you think will be in here?
Oh, the heroes?
Yeah.
I think you got Leviticus. I think you got Moses.
No.
I just threw in Leviticus.
Oh, yeah, we got Moses.
Monday's Moses. Then
tonight we got David and Goliath, Samson and Delilah, and Noah part one.
Noah part one. I imagine there's Noah part one through eight, probably.
There's two Noah parts. Part two's on Monday tomorrow. We got Joshua in the Battle of Jericho tomorrow, Moses in Egypt tomorrow. Tuesday is Moses and the Ten Commandments, Daniel in the Lion's Den, and the story of Joseph and his brothers, part one.
Is there a Last Supper in there?
Nope. Story of Joseph and his brothers, story of Solomon. And this is all like pre-Jesus.
Oh, damn.
This is all like
B.C.
Old Testament Bible.
All right.
This is, you know,
been down.
Exciting Bible. And Lucy Comes to Nashville is on that night, where Lucille Ball has a variety show special.
That was that night?
That's that night.
Okay.
Featuring the Oak Ridge Boys, Archie Campbell, Lynn Anderson, Barbara Mandrell, and Mel Tillis. Again, all country.
I like how I say that, like, oh, that's that night? I'm writing it down so I can
watch. Check that out.
We're not in it.
Canceling my show tonight.
Shit, okay.
Monday night, what'd you go with?
Well, actually, it was another big event, was Rock and Rollers.
Rock and Rollers.
Do you see that?
Let's see. Oh, yes.
Yeah.
It's like Grease on roller skates. That's what it says.
Yeah, that's what it says.
Bobby Vinton's Rock and Rollers, produced by Sid and Marty Kroft.
Yes.
Starring Penny Marshall, Eric Estrada, Stockard Channing, and Susan Buckner, Eve Arden, Gail Gordon, and a special appearance by Fabian.
Yep. I mean, I saw it. It was like, well, you know what actually caught my attention of it was the Sid and Marty Kroft.
Yes.
Well, and I only really know who they are because of Mr. Show with Bob and David.
Yes.
You know?
Because of the whole, altered states of Drugsachusetts.
The Drugsachusetts, yeah. And then, like, you go back and watch some of the stuff they were doing in the 70s. You were like, oh, yeah, these guys were fucking.
Yeah.
They were out there.
Bizarre, Sigmund and the Sea Monsters.
Yeah.
But they also produced most of the variety shows at that time. They produced the Donnie and Marie Show.
Yeah.
And a bunch of, because they were all vaudeville guys.
Yeah.
They were like guys producing, you know, puppet shows for vaudeville. So they were like, we can do a variety show. So they would get slapped with all these. They did the Bay City Rollers show and like all kinds of variety shows.
Have you ever heard of that one specifically?
I have not heard of this one.
Rock and Rollers?
This is Bobby Vinton is the host for a retrospective of the moods and music of the 1950s. Fabian, Stockard, list everyone here. In sketches, a visit from Fabian causes a panic in a malt shop. Penny plays a novice performer on roller skates. A capacity crowd crams into a fallout shelter.
Yeah, buddy.
Which is literally the plot of a Twilight Zone.
Yeah.
And beach party movies are spoofed. It's funny that this and the Frankie and Annette thing are on the same week, because we're getting the 70s was really the first time we had nostalgia, which sounds like a ridiculous statement, but it's true. They invented nostalgia in the 70s.
Yeah, you remember the 50s?
Yeah. Because teenagers didn't exist till the 50s. And they, because literally before that you were a kid and then you were an adult. There was nothing in between.
Right.
And in the 50s.
You're 13? Yeah. Oh, your voice dropped?
Now you're
get
married.
A job.
Yep.
Yeah.
Get in the mine. And then they were like, oh, we can market things to this in-between group. So that's the first time I think young people, you know, that started that 20-year cycle. So in the 70s, these guys are in their 30s. People in their 30s are like, I remember when I was a teenager. So we started to get this nostalgia stuff. Grease was a big part of it. American Graffiti was a big part of it.
Holy shit, you're right.
And they're really laying it on this week.
Yeah, that week was my first week of life. They wanted
all
people
about
to
the 50s.
Remember everything before it. Yeah.
You know, it's Thanksgiving week, so I'm wondering if part of it is like, there's a lot of like homecoming games and like high school reunions.
You're gonna be
and so
home.
They're like,
yeah,
people
yeah.
are already thinking that way, so let's put this stuff in there. Or I may be overthinking that. Anything
no,
else
no,
you
no,
have
I
that
think you're right. No, I went with that just because it was an all night event.
That has to be an all night event. The Prisoner is on that night too, which I would totally watch.
What is that?
Patrick McGowan, who's my favorite yelling Irish person, who is amazing.
I like in my head that you have a list of
my top 10
favorite yelling Irish.
Did you ever see the movie Scanners?
Yeah, dude.
Patrick McGowan's the doctor with the big beard.
Holy fucking.
Yeah.
Yep, there you go.
He was offered the part of James Bond, and he told him to go fuck themselves.
Go fuck yourself. Yeah,
he was,
that's a terrible Irish.
Oh, yeah.
That's a Scottish.
Yeah. He was in a show called Secret Agent Man, and he hated it. So he created his own show after that called The Prisoner, which is an unofficial sequel to Secret Agent Man, and it's about a secret agent who quits, and then the government kidnaps him and puts him on this island and tries to get his secrets out of his head and find out why he quit. But it's super trippy and weird, and they're always asking him like why he quit and like what he knows, and it's just 17 episodes of like what is happening and him yelling at people.
And that was the 70s though, where they would create a bond between like torturers and torturee.
Yeah,
where it would be like, well, all right,
yeah,
didn't get anything out of you today, Steve, did we? No, you fucking no. didn't.
Yep, the Patty Hearst.
But I'll see you tomorrow. Yes.
See you tomorrow.
See you tomorrow.
We just
see
work
you
together.
For the water button.
He would. There was a. He would always. They gave him a number. In it, they're like, you are number 6. And he's like, I am not a number. And it was like this, he'd go on these rants. I have a name. And it'd just be these whole things about him like being a person and not a, you know, not a tool of the government.
I have a name. That's fucking.
I am not a number.
Dude, that's, now I want to watch. Now I wish I would have written down The Prisoner.
The Prisoner's great. I highly recommend checking out The Prisoner, which you can see now is streaming on most things.
Seriously?
Yeah, yeah.
Wow.
They tried to remake it a couple years ago on AMC with Magneto. Ian McKellen.
Is he too old for that?
He was the boss, and the guy who they had, I think it was the guy who played Jesus in the Beat the Shit Out of Jesus movie. Passion of Christ.
Jim Cavill.
Yes. He was the Patrick McGowan part in it.
Wow, Jim, I pulled that name out of my fucking
head. Yeah, I'm
Jim
well
Cavill.
Done. Good pull.
I was gonna say Ewan McGregor, but he didn't play. I don't know why.
He looks like him.
He could play like a. I'm not a fucking nomad.
Yeah, I'm Jesus.
Also, I'm Scott. I could finally do a Scottish impersonation.
I always wished I had a Scottish accent. My grandparents were all from Scotland.
Dude, I went. I did Edinburgh last year, and we were me and this group. They're called the Reform Horse. They're this two girl. They're like a musical duo.
Oh yeah,
comedy.
Yeah.
They're great.
They did Women in Comedy this year. I think.
Yeah. And we were flatmates, and we had these two other Brits who are also, because you've got to live with a bunch of comedians.
Oh yeah, it's super expensive.
And then we all like do our shows and kind of meet up, and then one of the Reformed Horse, she's like, hey, I want to go to this like my friend told me about this real Scottish bar. Like, you guys want to go to this like real Scottish? Because we've just been hanging. We're like, sure, we go, and we get in there, and it's like you walk in. There's no jukebox. There's no music playing. There's just a bunch of fucking
lunatics.
Scots.
Yeah.
Just slamming back single malt and just staring you down.
Yeah, you don't belong there.
Yeah, you don't come. And it was, that's where you hear that Scottish where it's like, what are you saying? Write down what you're saying.
Yep.
I want to see if what you're saying is in an Irvin Welsh novel.
Those are my people.
Yeah, it's intense.
It is funny when my dad talks about his grandfather, because his grandfather was from Glasgow.
Glaswegian,
which is like the most incomprehensible Scottish. And my dad literally says, and like with like a tinge of sadness, is literally like, I never understood a word that he said. Like he literally never, he couldn't tell you a single thing.
Have you ever been to Scotland?
No, I've always wanted to go.
I tell you right now, Glasgow, I mean, Edinburgh is definitely a beautiful old castle driven city.
Right.
But like Glasgow,
it's an arts city.
Yes.
Yeah.
It definitely beautiful. But Glasgow is like, also, I think in the shadow of Edinburgh, but a bigger city. So somehow fitting into a tinier shadow, but I loved it. I think they're both. And Glaswegian's interesting because it's just, you realize it, just slow it down.
Yeah.
If like you could just slow a Glaswegian person down.
Yeah.
then you can hear what they're saying.
But then there'd be a Geordie.
But I have a Geordie, yeah, yeah.
So cold, man.
So cold. I'm from Manchester, Manchusian. Yeah.
So you do a lot of comedy in the UK?
I do. I go over there quite a bit.
I haven't been over back in like 8 years.
Yeah, it's fun. I like it over there.
I keep meaning to book shows. I'd love to go. My wife's from England. I met her. I lived over there. I started doing comedy over there.
There you go.
And I haven't been back in forever. And we have to go back for a brother's wedding next year. So I might go for a couple weeks and try to
stick around.
Shows. But I always wanted to go to Scotland. I'd never been. And I think the furthest north I've gone to do shows was like Birmingham.
Birmingham.
Yeah.
Or as I...
Birmingham?
The only... The joke, there when you just pronounce it like an American would, you're like Birmingham.
Yeah.
You're like, what?
Yeah.
What do you mean ham?
Welcome to Birmingham.
What do you mean ham?
Yeah.
Like a ham like bacon.
I love Geordies. Geordies are Sting is a Geordie for people that don't know. He's from Newcastle.
Yeah, yeah.
And which was amazing that Sting did that Broadway musical a couple of years ago.
Yeah.
And they sued him for it because whoever produced it was like, oh, we'll get a Sting musical where it's like a jukebox musical. It's just the music of the Police and Sting.
Yeah.
But Sting, who grew up like super working class in this northern fishing village, wrote an original musical about growing up in the 50s in like a Gloucester, like a dying fishing town.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And it was really good. And they were like, we just wanted Every Breath You Take.
Yeah.
And so it was a huge bomb.
Sorry.
Yeah. He's like, oh, man. But it's like super Geordie. Like everyone in it sings with like these really heavy accents.
Yeah.
And it's really cool.
So he's like sitting in the crowd. He's like, I can kind of understand you.
Yeah. Yeah.
But I'd like you to not have that.
Do you know Vic Reeves and Bob Mortimer?
Yes.
They had a show called Cataric. Did you ever see that?
No.
It's amazing. It's bizarre and Cataric. Funny. And there's a guy who they hang out in the pub with, and the whole show he's just talking about he's trying to get a job, and his wife's super cold because she's dead, but like just inferred. It's like, the wife is so cold, man. You know, I got to get a job to heat her up. And so she's just so bloody cold. And it's like the weird, but it's funny.
Yeah.
But at one point he goes, the office gave me a job as a bass player in a jazz funk band. And a job ended up going to a black fella, and rightly so. But it's just like this bizarre thing.
Like,
and it's
what?
So much funnier because he's got this Geordie accent.
I think even they are enamored with the accent.
Well, the North is the South of England.
Yeah, exactly.
What the South is to America, the North is to England.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's, it's got like a drawl.
Like some of them you can't. There's also things like Manchester people, anything that ends with an A, like the name Sophie would be Sophie.
Yeah,
there's like a weird like at the end, like, oh, I'm gonna go play.
And they also do, but there's also weird, it's not even accent stuff, it's like weird wording, like they'll always say like Arshon.
Yeah.
Which is, you ever seen the Royle Family?
No,
the
actually,
sitcom.
No.
That's also streaming, and it's one of the most amazing things I've ever seen. It's this Manchester family, working class family. Every episode's in real time, and it's them sitting around the couch watching TV. Every episode, that's it. And it's brilliant and funny and blue-collar and sad, and it's so good.
Really?
They tried to do a version of it here that they called The Kennedys, and it took place in Charlestown, Mass.
Okay.
And Randy Quaid was in it, and it was awful. Like, it just didn't work. And the British one is... It's one of my favorite sitcoms ever, and it's
because the Brits understand nuance.
Yeah,
they understand. Yeah. Yeah, yeah. Where it's like here, it's just like, will it get Randy Quaid?
Yeah, just be crazy. It's J.K. Rowling's favorite show.
Really,
she loves it,
okay.
And it's amazing. And the guy who wrote it is named Craig Cash, and he wrote it with this woman Carolyn Ahern, who actually died last year. But after the Royle Family, he did a show called Early Doors that was the same thing, but set in a pub. And it's basically like a Manchester version of Cheers,
okay.
But is unbelievably good.
So much to get through.
I know. I'm sorry. You have a whole list here.
No, I'm talking about so much. I'm just talking about TV shows to watch.
Yeah.
It's like so
much.
It's like, fuck.
Yeah. There's some great stuff. I mean, there's a ton of good stuff. I love Early Doors. They're both, the cool thing about all the streaming services is they've realized that they have an untapped just gold mine of British stuff that they can stream for cheap that's already been made, and so we can see all these British shows.
Yeah, so like the Royle Family is probably only what, 2-3 seasons?
It's 4 seasons of 7 episodes each.
Yeah, see?
Over like a 10-year period.
Quick, easy. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Not quick,
yeah,
but you know.
You could do the whole thing in a day.
But I like how they do that in England, where they're just like,
well, yeah.
No, three, we'll do it about 3 seasons.
Cuz it's just quality, like in
quality
the
over
people
quantity.
Who wrote it star in it. too. Yeah, so it's like, yeah, Royle Family's amazing. It's
all right. I'm definitely gonna look into that.
It's
one.
A, like that show will make you cry, and you'll love this family. And it's so hard to explain to people because I'm like, they make an engaging, funny, bittersweet show that's 30 minutes of people watching TV. That's it.
All right.
And it's so good. Tuesday night, what'd you go with?
Oh, Tuesday, I went with the classics. I went Laverne and Shirley.
Yep.
Into Three's Company.
Yep.
Into Taxi.
Yeah, it was a classic TV night.
It's one of those like, oh, those three in a row?
Also, there's a weird ad in here for a thing called Cruncher Munch.
Cruncher Munch, huh?
Cruncher Munch, which looks like a weird rival to like Cracker Jacks. But it's just Cruncher Munch for peanut lovers. I always love those, like, you ever have Screaming Yellow Zonkers or Fiddle Faddle?
Fiddle Faddle, buddy. Fiddle Faddle all the fucking day.
I'm a Fiddle Faddle guy.
It's also, yeah, like, well, for people, Crunch and Munch, if you don't want any of that dumb popcorn caramel bullshit,
yeah,
we just got fucking peanuts.
It's just peanuts, man.
I mean, you could technically just go get peanuts, but that wouldn't be Crunch and Munch.
It's not Crunch and Munch. It doesn't have the box.
It doesn't have the name.
No prizes. That's for kids. What are we? No. What are we, babies?
Babies.
I'm here to eat peanuts.
But I'm going
to
tell you right now, babies can also eat it.
It's fine for them unless they got, I don't know why I'm being Southern here.
Nah, because I think it's Crunch and Munch.
That's who eats Crunch and Munch?
Fuck yeah, yeah.
Crunch and Munch and Mountain Dew?
Crunch and Munch, Mountain Dew, what the hell is that? We're a fucking Mello Yello people.
Oh, Mello Yello, you're right.
Yeah.
Crunch and Munch, Mello Yello.
Yep.
And it has to be two words that rhyme.
Crunch and Munch, Mello Yello. Smith and Wesson. That don't rhyme, but it does.
But
you know what I mean?
You know what I'm saying? It has a ring to it.
Yeah.
They only eat rhyming foods. Yeah, this is an amazing night. This is the classic lineup. It's all new episodes. You get Laverne and Shirley, and then did you say Three's Company at 9?
Oh yeah.
Yep. Three's Company. Oh, yeah. Taxi. Three's Company, I always felt like I was gonna get in trouble for, because that was just like a horny show.
Exactly.
So sleazy.
Yeah. It was just hormones floating around.
Yeah.
John Ritter. But that's why you know when they saw John Ritter, they're like, oh, we got to get this guy to play the lead because he's sort of like the saltpeter.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah. And he could be like all horned up, but didn't seem threatening.
Exactly.
Like, he's not going to commit a sexual assault.
No.
He's just like, oh, I'm going to dry hump things.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I'm going to go and pray this boner away.
Yeah. Suzanne Summers had quit Three's Company by this time. So.
Oh, really?
Yeah, she quit over, she was one of the first big exits of a TV show over money, because she was like, I'm the star of this show. And they were like, see ya.
Really?
So she was recast. They brought in new people. So it's interesting because opposite Three's Company that night on a different channel is the Dean Martin roast of Suzanne Summers.
Really?
Yes. Which is pretty great. They have Audra Lindy, Rich Little, Orson Welles, LaWanda Page, Tom Bosley, Bernie Coppell, Red Buttons, Norm Crosby, Paul Anka, Charlie Callis, Milton Berle, Dr. Joyce Brothers, and Zsa Zsa Gabor roasting Suzanne Summers with Dean Martin.
And that was back when they were all friends.
Yep.
And they would
just bust each other's balls.
Do it classy.
Yeah, I don't.
Yeah.
People get mad at me because I don't like the roasts. But part of it is I'm like, but that was all you were seeing, people that knew each other. It wasn't just like, I'm going to say a mean thing to this person I don't know.
Here we go. Round one. We're going to talk about, I don't know who you are because your career's shit. Well,
yep.
I don't know who you are because your career's shit.
Yep.
All right, round two. Well, you're definitely fat.
You're gay and fat.
Well, you're definitely gay.
Yeah.
Oh, because those are two things you should still make fun of.
Yeah.
Third round. Well, your joke sucks. Well, then here's an even meaner version of what you just said.
Also mixed in with a really offensive topical reference about a major catastrophe that recently happened.
Yeah, exactly. You look like a school shooter.
Yeah.
You know, it's always like the guy who won Mike Lawrence won the Comedy Central.
Yeah.
And like Mike won because Mike's a brilliant joke writer and a great comedian, and everyone, I think, assumed that there would be another roaster to come out of that.
Yeah.
It's like you watch some of these and you're like, but what is the fucking,
what's the point here?
It's just,
yeah. It's funny that that's what they took away from these roasts, because these roasts were always, these people are all friends and they're busting each other's balls and that's what people like.
Yeah.
And then it just became this weird, it's so weird to me that a lot of the younger comics in Boston hate me because they think I'm mean because I told them it was pointless to do really mean shows, because that there was a while here where like open mics would just do roast shows.
Yeah.
And I'm like, the audience doesn't know who you are. The people who are roasting each other don't know who each other are. so it's just two strangers being mean, and they're like, "You're mean."
Well, you're like, being mean.
Yeah, like I don't get it, man. Yeah. I don't get it. But Suzanne Summers, I bet this is really funny. Yeah. I love watching those old
ones. Who took Suzanne Summers' place?
She was replaced by Pamela Barnes. Was that her name?
Jesus.
And then she was replaced by who I used to call her the Scooby Dumb, because she was a, like, they did like a hick Southern cousin, and it was played by I can't remember her name. It's three words, but yeah, they had three different people replace her over the years. They could never find anyone who was the new Suzanne Summers. They just couldn't do it.
Wow.
Yeah, Joyce DeWitt was always there. She
and
was
then
the
Suzanne Summers would go on to be in that show
She's
with Patrick
the sheriff.
Dempsey.
Patrick Duffy.
Duffy, Patrick Duffy.
Yeah, called Step by Step.
Step by Step is what that show is called.
The 90s Brady Bunch, Step by Step.
There was an episode of South Park where there was a monster where Patrick Duffy, one of his legs was Patrick Duffy.
Yeah.
I thought that was really funny.
Patrick Duffy's a great punchline.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
He was, I mean, he was a huge TV star.
Was he?
He was on Dallas. He was J.R. Ewing's son on Dallas, okay. Bobby. And he was also in The Man from Atlantis before that, which was basically Aquaman. But it was a huge hit for like 2 years.
Yeah, yeah.
And the show was too expensive, so they canceled it. But like Patrick Duffy was an enormous star, which is hilarious because now you're just like, he's a punchline guy.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You mention Patrick Duffy and everyone laughs.
Patrick Duffy.
And Patrick Duffy.
Probably because of Step by Step.
Yeah, yeah.
Because that show was just like, okay, someone wants their paycheck.
Yeah, but it was on for 9 seasons.
Yeah, it was a...
And was a weirdly huge hit.
Huge hit.
Which is bizarre.
And it was always, no, honey, I'll take care of it. Because you remember, it was also like, it was also that thing that multicams did where it was a multicam, but not shot indoors.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So it was like, because they did that a lot with like the full houses, and it was like, or like even episodes of Seinfeld did this where it was like, so what are they doing? Just showing this footage to?
Yeah, the show to the audience.
Laughter over it maybe?
Yeah, yeah. Because I've gone to tapings. I went to, you know Alex Edelman?
I
Edelman,
do.
Yeah. When Edelman was writing for Great Indoors last year, Rachel and I were in town and we went to a taping, and there was like 3 remotes they did, and they just showed us the video footage.
Yeah,
and the audience laugh at it, but I'm like, why is this audience here to just watch this on a monitor? That's what they, I guess they started doing it then.
They did that a lot on Step by Step, I remember.
Oh yeah, yeah, and it was, but the weirdest thing with Step by Step that really put me off was that Patrick Duffy and Suzanne Summers were like, again, the Three's Company thing, they were like super horny for each other all the time. Yeah. It was like gross parent stuff. And it would be like really blunt. Like it would be like, all right, well, I'm going to take your mom upstairs and bang her. Like, it'd be just like really like, what?
Well, your dad's worked hard, so I'm going to go and work hard for him.
Yeah, it was that like, kind of stuff.
What?
It was like, we don't want to.
You're in your 50s.
Yeah, and I think they thought it was like okay because the parents would watch it or like the people who watched them on shows in the 80s. Yeah, but I don't know. Wednesday night, what are you going with?
Wednesday night, and I'm going to mess this up, but there was the Steve Martin Wild and Crazy Guy special.
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah.
Which is really good.
Yeah. I was like, I would definitely watch that in real time on network television.
Steve Martin did some really great, weird network specials in the late 70s, early 80s that I can't believe he
got away with.
Air.
Yeah, yeah.
Like the Just the Commercials one. Ever seen that?
No.
He did one called Just the Commercials, and it's just like an hour of commercial parodies.
Okay.
But it's really bizarre. So this might be his first one, but this is sketches feature brief appearances by Bob Hope, George Burns, Milton Berle, Johnny Cash, Strother Martin. But the show belongs to Steve. Vaudeville, slapstick, and satire combined as he slips into some 15 different roles, including a judge at a tennis court where the accused stands charged with possession of an errant backhand, a ski instructor with a penchant for pratfalls, a ballet as opposed to a valet parking attendant prancing to Swan Lake, and an outdoorsman leading a troop of young hikers in campfire songs, an Egyptian dancer gilding to Disco Tut. So this is when he did that King Tut thing on SNL. And a cowboy who wears his gal's dress for good luck while breaking a bronco. A giant tortoise. So, and the photo is literally him in a dress riding a tortoise.
Yeah, man. And that was just on TV.
Yeah. I mean, this time they're also given like a Richard Pryor special.
A Richard Pryor
special. Like it was, and Steve Martin was arguably the most famous stand-up ever at this point.
At that point.
Like, selling our arenas.
First arena comic. Yeah. Do that shit? Yeah.
So he could do anything he wanted. Like, they were just like, yeah, sure, do whatever you want. And all those specials are streaming for free now on Amazon, I think all of them are. And they're funny. Like, they hold up well.
I mean, I read Steve, if you read any of Steve Martin's books, there's some, like, there's one called Pure Drivel that is just that, but there's just entire passages of just like, what?
Oh, yeah. I mean, I love Born Standing Up.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, that was a great, but I mean, like, that was like a, that was like his, yeah. But like his, like, Pure Drivel
is fiction stuff?
Yeah, just like, or it's not even, it's just like random, non sequitur.
Oh, his brain works bizarre.
Yeah. But man, was it funny stuff. But yeah, and yeah, when you read Born Standing Up, you're like, you can understand, like, if you're doing, you're performing for 70,000 people.
Yeah.
It's like, I could probably suck.
Hi, how's it going? Oh. Are you guys with basketball here? No, we're with Laugh.
Okay, with Laugh, yeah. Wouldn't mind.
Unfortunately, they're renting out the space. Oh, okay. Like, oh, okay, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
We can, yeah. Oh, yeah, we can move it. Yeah,
we can move it, yeah. Thank
you. You're welcome. So we've been moved.
We had to move.
The Fallen Heroes, I think it was called.
Yeah, yeah.
And it was like either dead cops or like, no, it was like dead army dudes.
Army, I believe the military, and I believe they need, no one can be in their space.
They rented the space.
Yeah.
So we are now sort of looking above where the bar is.
But we were talking about Steve Martin.
Yes, yes.
You know, good time to get interrupted there.
Yes. We were talking about the hotel because this hotel does seem like a Star Trek spaceship.
Yeah, it's massive. It's massive.
And it's always weird because I always, every hotel I've ever gone in, there's always day drinking.
Oh, always day drinking. And then always really sad night drink. Like, you'll come back to the hotel and you'll see, like, people sitting at the bar, like, looking around.
Yeah.
Like, waiting for that other, like, person to be like, can I get one more?
Yeah.
It's like, what room are you in? Let's go fuck.
It's okay. Yeah, yeah. I'm not like this, so this might be why I think everyone's like this. I'm like, everyone here is just trying to get laid. I don't know why. I just assume everybody always is.
Everybody always is.
So we ended here on Thanksgiving, Thursday night, actual Thanksgiving. What'd you go?
Oh, I got two more. I got Thursday and then Friday.
Yep.
All right. So Thursday on Thanksgiving, again, classic. I went Mork and Mindy.
Yep.
To What's Happening.
I love What's Happening.
Which predated What's Happening Now.
Yes.
Yeah.
Which was Martin, not Martin. Yeah, Martin
Lawrence?
Martin Lawrence's first TV role.
Really?
He was a regular on What's Happening Now.
Well, then that, yep.
And which is pre-Def Comedy Jam, which is hilarious seeing him be like super clean.
Yeah, yeah,
and like
yeah.
playing kind of a dork.
Playing and then be like, I'm going to show you.
Yeah.
I'm the bad boy.
Yeah.
I'm even going to pull a gun out in traffic. And
What's
then,
Happening? Rerun. Yeah. Goes on a reckless buying spree with his newfound clout, a bank credit card.
Damn, back when that was, that's probably how they were like, let's introduce credit cards into the black community.
Yeah, it probably was. They did that on Leave It to Beaver. They introduced the concept of layaway. I think it was Sears and Roebuck paid them to do an episode about layaway.
Really?
To introduce the concept to people, so they'd do it.
I mean, they definitely, yeah, you realize how many big sponsors came in and was like, hey, we kind of want to advertise.
Yeah.
You know.
Maybe you could, you
payment
know.
Payment plans, yeah. You know. I know, you're a TV people, you'll figure it out.
Maybe black people could sign up for credit cards.
Like, you know, we want more people in debt. Yeah.
Did you do Barney Miller at 9?
Actually, no, I went Hawaii 5-0.
I mean, I like Hawaii 5-0. This is the only show my grandfather used to watch, who was an angry
Barney
man
Miller?
From Norway. Hawaii 5-0. Called it his Hawaii program. This one is a phony preacher spreads a gospel of sin. Armed assault and a violent death put McGarrett on the trail of a fraudulent evangelist who seduces his female parishioners and fleeces them of their savings.
You know, and that's, as you're saying that, I realize that I had Hawaii 5-0 mistaken for Chips.
Oh, yeah, that's much different.
Yeah.
Yeah, Chips was earlier in the week.
Yeah?
Chips was on Monday night, I think. Hawaii 5-0, though, I mean, I enjoyed, because it's Hawaii, and I liked surf music.
Exactly, and dun, seeing dun, 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 cops dressed for beachwear. Yeah.
But Barney Miller, which is still one of my favorite shows, which I watch all the time still.
Seriously?
Really funny. It's the show that I always tell people, if you're trying to write comedy, watch Barney Miller, because every episode's a bottle episode. It's one room for 200 episodes, five characters, it's talking. That's it.
Really?
For 200 episodes. And it's funny and never gets boring. And it's just great. It's so funny.
Really? Wait, what is the premise of Barney Miller?
It's a New York police precinct. That's it.
That's it.
Just the, and it's the quote is that it's cop's favorite cop show because it's the most realistic because it's literally mostly doing paperwork.
Right.
So it's the office stuff at a police station. And the detectives are called for an automat, to an automat, where the patients from a psychiatric clinic are running amok. It was actually created by the mentor of Reinhold Weege, who created Night Court. So it's it has a lot of the DNA of Barney Miller is in Night Court. It's if you like Night Court, Barney Miller is
which
sort of
also somewhat. Would you call it a bottle episode?
Yeah, it's all mostly in that same two sets.
Yeah,
Night Court is like a slightly more silly version of Barney Miller.
Okay,
but a lot of the same writers, a lot of the same actors.
Was Barney Miller multicam?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah.
But not in front of a live audience.
No.
So the weird thing is, so Danny Arnold, that created that show, was kind of a tyrant, and he did the first three episodes in front of an audience. Hated it so much.
Yeah.
Ruined the show because he was like, we're trying to play to these people who I don't give a fuck about.
Yeah.
So he convinced the network to ditch the audience, which was unheard of. And they would can laughter in later, but it was not in front of a live audience. It's really interesting.
I respect that though.
Oh yeah. And that's Reinhold Weege, who did Night Court, like learned so much from Danny Arnold, who was the kind of guy that people were like, he was a real asshole, but he was really good at his job.
Yeah.
Like it was that kind of thing.
Respect that.
Sing Sing Thanksgiving, which is did you see that?
No, I missed that.
So you're like, oh, it must be a musical Thanksgiving, right?
No.
Nope.
Yeah, it's a
1972 Thanksgiving Day concert taped at Sing Sing Prison.
Wow.
Among the performers are B.B. King, Joan Baez, Mimi Farina, comedian Jimmy Walker, and the gospel group The Voices of East Harlem.
Man.
I kind of like the idea of that, though.
Yeah.
Like, it's Thanksgiving. Like, they're giving a concert for these people in prison.
You know, it's like, yeah, you know, they took their time to rob us and murder some of us.
We should get B.B. King.
Yeah, let's give them some free entertainment.
Yeah. I mean, they make all the rapists stay in their cell.
Yeah,
I think that should be the compromise.
Yeah.
If they're just murderers.
But if they're just murderers and drug peddlers, bring them out here.
I mean, Jimmy Walker's allowed to make them laugh.
Yeah. Also, drug peddlers, let them go. They shouldn't be in there anyway.
Have you ever done a show with Jimmy Walker?
No, is he still around?
Yeah, I've done shows with him.
Really?
Yeah, super clean. You got to be squeaky clean.
Really?
But yeah, really nice guy.
Does he still dynamite?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, really? He's got the whole thing, yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, he's working it. And then they're rerunning Harpsichord Maker at 10:30, by the way.
Well, it was a big hit earlier in the week.
I mean, people are like...
People were stacked up to see it.
I can see that again. I'm picturing everyone who saw it Monday, who like, everyone's over their house for Thanksgiving, and they're like, you guys got to watch this.
You just also...
sit down.
You just also snuck in such a Boston saw...
I saw it.
Yeah. I was like, whoa, just snuck it in.
Kid, did you see that fucking harpsichord maker?
That fucking harpsichord guy, he knows what you do. That's fucking magical.
I think he's queer, but I don't fucking care.
Yeah, I don't care. You know what? But you know what? If all queer people's magical like him,
fucking make a harpsichord?
Fucking brilliant. Dude.
Come on into my fucking apartment, get in the parlor, and make me a fucking harpsichord with your angelic fingers.
Yeah, it takes my emotions, puts them into something I can fucking play.
Oh my God, it's fucking music to my ears. Literally. So the final night of the week, Friday night, what'd you go with?
Friday night. And start off with Wonder Woman.
I'd like to start and finish with Wonder Woman.
Yeah, we got start. Start with Wonder Woman. If you notice here, I got a ring on.
Yes.
That is Wonder Woman's helmet. I didn't know it was when my mom got it for me.
Oh, you didn't know it was?
My mom got it for me over a decade ago, and I just put it on. I was like, yeah, Mom, I'll wear it.
Did she know what it was?
She didn't either.
Yeah.
We were in Cozumel, and she got it. But that's not why. Also,
it's super cool, by the way.
It's a chill ring. It's also like Wonder Woman, when you watch like the most recent Wonder Woman film, and you go back and see these old... It's like, man, they didn't intend to make her good at anything except for looking...
Well, Linda Carter is stunning.
Like, she's
stunning. And it's the funny thing about Wonder Woman, that is a show that switched networks.
It was
on ABC for the first season.
Okay.
The first season was set in World War II.
Okay.
It got canceled. CBS picked it up, and all of a sudden it was set in the 70s with no explanation.
Really?
Yeah. And it's real set in the 70s. And this episode is... one of the best examples of how 70s it
was.
Wonder Woman skates for her life. Can she save a teenage skateboard superstar from death on wheels? Trying to keep the odds against a gambling kingpin, Wonder Woman gets unexpected help from a friend's teenage daughter, a skateboarder with a photographic memory. There is full-on Wonder Woman in a helmet skateboarding.
Jesus. She doesn't use her invisible jet that somehow doesn't make her invisible?
Nope. Full-on skateboarding Wonder Woman.
Jesus. They were trying to make her more modern.
Yeah. Oh yeah. And it's a fun episode.
Well, so then the Wonder Woman lineage. Okay, so she was in the comic books set in World War II then.
Not at this point. So in the late 60s, the Avengers was so popular that they depowered her and made her like an Emma Peel super secret agent spy.
Really?
By the 70s, the show was so popular, they discoed it and set it in the 70s. In 1984, sort of post-crisis, George Perez took over Wonder Woman and reinvented her as like the Greek goddess thing. That's when they brought in all the god stuff. But for the most part before that, was pretty World War II-ish.
Okay. That seems like a lot. Yeah. Well, then after Wonder Woman, I went NBA basketball, just because to see the guys pre-baggy shorts.
Yep.
Where they're all bouncing around.
Knee-high socks.
Yeah, just
Chuck Taylors.
And it was, I believe, the Detroit Pistons versus the Atlanta Hawks. Just interesting to see. And then from there, go into the Mary Tyler Moore show, because why wouldn't you?
Really great show.
During the heyday.
Yep.
See, what was his name? I would like to have seen...
Lou Grant?
No, he played Judge Schmales in Ted Knight.
Oh, Ted Knight, yes.
Yeah, yeah.
Lou.
Yeah. See Ted Knight. And then end it with Fun with Dick and Jane.
Fun with Dick and Jane, which is a world premiere movie. They're showing the movie on TV that night.
Which would have been a late night, but Friday night you would have stayed in.
ABC Friday night movie, Bonnie and Clyde It Ain't. It's Fun with Dick and Jane with Jane Fonda and George Segal. Very funny. And also there's this particular edition, I think, is a North Carolina edition. And their local horror host is Ashley Gastly on Scream Theater showing The Mask of Red Death.
Who was the local horror host or...
We had a thing. It was Creature Double Feature that was hosted by Dale Dorman, who was a morning radio DJ, Uncle Dale. But he didn't appear on camera. It was only his voice. That was on TV 56. Okay. And then we also had the Movie Loft with Dana Hersey.
Okay.
Who's still around.
We had Morgus Presents.
Morgus?
Morgus.
Oh, nice.
He was just a mad scientist.
What was, do you remember the like the most memorable movie you saw on Morgus?
I mean, I don't know. I just remember laughing at Morgus. Morgus.
And he was
like a mad scientist, and he had a talking skeleton head robot.
Of course he did.
Yeah,
of course.
And it was always a lot of smoke coming out of a lot of beakers.
The fish
of El Guapaluto Bay or whatever.
I lament the fact that kids don't have that local weird,
man.
Where that weatherman's double shifting as the horror host on the weekends and it's kind of sad that doesn't exist anymore
and like how it's all everything's made to be watched on a phone or binge watched. Speaking of binge watched, have you watched Cobra Kai yet?
I've seen the first two episodes and they're amazing.
I tell you what, right now, dude, there you will not find a cheesier show that is more perfect in every way.
It's just like... Because Daniel was an asshole.
When you start to realize, wait a second. And then, but also start to like, how they do so well. The one thing they do so, because I just finished the season. And the one thing they do so well in that show is really capture the reality that there's no such thing as a good guy or a bad guy.
Yeah.
There's just damaged
shades
people
of gray.
Dealing with it. It's
people that had a good day or a bad day.
Yeah.
Yeah, and it's all whose perspective are you seeing this from?
Yeah.
I do love these, not reboots, but sequel series, the What's Happening Now of our day, if you will. Where they show us where these people are 20 years later.
And why they were.
Yeah.
And also, like, I'm wondering if this is going to start a trend.
Of course.
And you know it is, yeah. Like, so, but, like, what movie are they going to take? Like, I'm thinking...
Goonies.
Oh my God!
Sean Astin told me that he's written a sequel.
Oh my!
That takes
God.
Place now with everybody.
Is everybody alive?
Yeah.
Well, actually, Chunk is an entertainment lawyer.
Yep, yep.
Jeff Cohen.
Yeah, he was the Walsh Brothers lawyer for a while.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, everyone's still alive.
Yeah, yeah.
Everyone's around.
I wonder if he would be willing to do it.
I bet he'd do it.
Yeah, yeah.
We know Feldman would.
Yeah, exactly. I was about to say.
Yeah.
Wait, even... Oh, yeah, Josh Brolin.
Josh Brolin,
yeah.
Martha Plimpton. Yep.
Well, yeah, yeah.
Yep.
Fuck, wait, wait.
Cary Green, who's not acting anymore, but I bet she'd do it.
Yeah, yeah. Who played Short Round?
Oh, Ki Kwan.
Is he still around?
Yeah, he's still around, yeah.
Dude.
He's still Short Round.
Dude.
Yeah, everyone's around. I mean, I'd watch that. Were you thinking of a different one?
Wait, his name is Data in Goonies.
Data, yeah.
Yeah, he's Short Round in Indiana Jones.
Pitches of Death.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. $50 bill.
Yeah.
Yeah. That guy. Fuck, Goonies. Okay, Goonies would be... Damn, dude. You might have just nailed it. Because I was thinking there was part of me that thought Back to the Future, but then it's like, well, it's kind of difficult to...
Yeah,
for,
I don't know how you
Michael
would do
J.
it.
Fox yeah. to... Yeah.
And time travel movies doing a where are they now thing.
It's like, we know, yeah. We know how they got there.
Yeah.
Wait, I mean, fuck, man. You might have...
Gremlins.
Gremlins could be interesting. Or like Monster Squad.
Yeah. Well, this sounds ridiculous to say, but my buddies, my friends are guys from Monster Squad.
Really?
And Andre, who plays Sean, has written a sequel to it. And he just did a documentary about Monster Squad called Wolfman's Got Nards.
Well, dude. Wolfman's Got Nards?
Yeah. So they've been trying to do that as well.
That would be...
He's been trying to get that going for a while.
That, you know what? I hope it happens. Fucking A.
He has, to, I can't, I've sworn to secrecy, but off mic I can tell you if you want to know. Actually, he told me not to, but I know what the plot is for the sequel.
Oh, dude, no, I want to be surprised like the rest of America.
Yeah.
When that becomes what YouTube Red does.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. That would be fantastic.
Which.
Yeah.
There needs to be a streaming service that picks it like a thing. Like, we do this now.
Yeah, totally.
We make sequel series
to movies
out of
you loved as a kid.
Yeah. Oh man.
Yeah, I mean those got to be the big ones. I can't think of anything else. We've already got a Terminator TV series that was a sequel that was no good. Young Indiana Jones already happened. I mean that's all the big stuff.
I mean one that could be interesting would be E.T.
Yeah, like what's back. Elliot doing now?
Yeah, like what's Elliot, like that, yeah.
Because that kid's going to be fucked up.
Yeah, dude.
And like no one believes him.
Yeah,
that
exactly. And Drew Barrymore, still around. She could play the sister of the fucked up older brother. Does she even believe the alien was real?
No.
You know?
It's a delusion by her brother who's been in it, you know, has had problems ever since.
Yeah, and the older brother who's just like sworn he's off, he found Jesus.
Yeah, he's not calling people penis breath anymore.
Yeah.
Yeah, that would be a great
one. There you go.
Yeah, I think we did it.
We found it.
Yep, let's pitch it.
E.T.
We're going to make a ton of money.
All right, done.
All right, cool. Well, thank you for doing this.
Ken, thank you for having me.
Let's go eat lobster rolls.
All right.
There you go. New Orleans' own Sean Patton. I totally said that wrong. New Orleans, down New Orleans. And you know, I didn't bring it up in the episode, but I think the most accurate representation of New Orleans I've seen is they did 8 episodes of Cops there during Mardi Gras. And, that was pretty excellent. I didn't ask Sean if that was an accurate representation, but I imagine it had to be in that it's essentially a documentary series about drunk people being arrested. Or just beat up, either way. Anyway, that was a fun episode, as is always the case for me. Hopefully it was for you as well. If you'd like to email me, that's at the beginning of the episode. If you want to give to the Patreon, it's patreon.com/TV Guidance Counselor. You can go on Twitter at TV Guidance, Instagram at TV Guidance. I am there personally as well at Kenneth W. Reed. Brand new episodes each and every Wednesday, so be sure that you subscribe to the show. And we'll see you again next time on a brand new edition of TV Guidance Counselor.
God damn, you do know a lot about TV shows.
I love my TV.